Thanks for being here with this introduction to Backbone.js. So first, let me ask you a few questions. So who is developing web apps? Good, great. And who is using jQuery? Excellent. So then my last question is, did you feel like this guy at some point? I mean, your code is becoming very large and it's like a bunch of spaghetti code. I mean, you don't have so much more fun because it's not maintainable anymore. So one of the solutions to help you get maintainable code is to use this tiny library called Backbone.js. And I will not give you a theoretical demonstration. I want to go deep into a practical example. This example is called Super Top Friends. It's like, you know, this this first application on a social network on MySpace or early on Facebook. You log in and then you select your best friends and then you can tell everyone, hey, look at my best friends. So this is the first page of the application. It's not using any server, it's serverless. So let me log in on Facebook. Good. I'm logging. And you can see the second page. So basically, we have on the left our friends, and on the right we have the readers, I mean our top friends. And I can just browse my friends and select the best one. So Alexandre is my first one, another Alexandre, and you can choose like this. And once you have selected five top friends, there is a publish button. You can click on it and you can publish on Facebook and tell, okay, that's my friend, my best friend. So, very simple app. This app is data driven. It means that usually with jQuery, you create your markup and then you add your callbacks, and at some point it gets messy because you don't know what is the beginning, how it's working on. Here it's data driven. It means that first you take your application, you analyze it and you say, okay, that's my data models. And then when people, users, they interact with your application, they will directly modify data, and this data will send events and views. What you see will automatically update themselves. So basically we use four different data structure from Backbone: the models, the collections, the views, and a router. This is the file structure of this Super Top Friends app. You see it's very simple, there is only one HTML file, and then we have a bunch of JS files, the collections, models, views. So let's begin to delve into the app. So the first thing I want to show you is the router. This is really the entry point of the Backbone application. It's represented like this. You create your app. It extends backbone.router. And then inside you can define your routes. So for each key value of this root object, you define a root. This is the root of the application. You see, this is the first page. And for the value landing, you tell okay for the root. When I type the root URL, I will go into the landing application function. And then for the second page, okay, if you type dash hash friends, you will go into friends function. So pretty simple. So then let's analyze this application. We have two data models. We have the friends, of course. So each friend is a picture, name, and inside there is also an ID, a Facebook ID, and there is also a winner's model. This winner's model represents the five best of friends. Let's begin with the winner's model. So winner's model, just extend hardball.model, and inside I can define default values for the data that will be inside. This is not mandatory, but it's good practice to so that when you read your code, you know, okay, this is the kind of data I will store. So you see, I have my five best friends with some default values. I have also an initialized function. For now, there is not so much to do. Then let's go back into our browser. This is how we initialize winner's model object. Winner's model is a new winner's model, pretty simple in the initialize function. Then we have our friend model. This one is almost empty. There is only an initialize function because you can store whatever data you want in a model. You can even add them at runtime. You can modify them, so you don't have to specify the defaults. Then, this friend model, we create a bunch of them. We don't know how many of them we create because they come from Facebook. And to enter them, we use the collections that we call friends collection. And this friend collection will be responsible to create this model and to store them. This is our collection. Same kind of initialization, we extend backdoor the collection. And inside, there is an important property. We specify what kind of model we can store inside this collection. Here, it's a friend model. Then we have also an access token. Here, we need this because we interact with the Facebook API. So we need at some point to set the access token. Here, this is the URL. This is a function that returns a string that can be also a string. And you can see that I will be using it to define where I fetch my data from my collection. This is from Facebook, graph.facebook.com/new/friends. And here, I initialize it like the reverse model, which is a cohort. What is interesting now is that when we go in friends mode, you see that I'm calling the fetch method of the friends collection. This fetch method will implicitly use the URL I have defined previously to fetch the data. And for each of these data, the collection will create a model. This is an example of the kind of data received from Facebook. So you see it's an array of key value objects. So for example, there is my friend Salman Khan. So the collection will create a model for Salman, a friend, a user for Karina, etc. Automatically you will get models in your collection. So then we have our data, our collections. We need to begin to have some views. The first view is the landing view. This is really the first screen we see on the app. To instantiate it, first you see the landing view is connected to a friend, is linked to a friend collection. So to represent this link in code, it's very simple. You can just instantiate your landing view and you specify what collections will be linked. Collection, but this is my friend's collection. Then, here, this is the code of the views, the landing view. As usual, we extend backdoor the view this time. Inside, we have this EL property, which is important because it's, you tell the view, okay, you will get attached to the DOM at the view entry selector. If we go now in the index.html file, you see I have defined a div with the ID view entry. And all my views will be attached here. Then I have the initialize function. Inside, you can define a template. You can use whatever template engine you want. This is one of the strengths of the Backbone. It's very flexible. Here, I'm just using some underscore template, very simple one, and define, okay, you can find this template at this selector, landing view template. We go back in the HTML file. You see, this is my template that I defined directly on the page, very simple. And then for each view, you have to define a render function. So each time you want to display this landing view, this render function will be called. And inside, you see, this is the way that you specify, okay, here is the HTML that you will use to render the page. You use your template and you specify your HTML. And you see, we just call this render function in the router again when the landing function will be called. And the view will be attached in the DOM directly. We are in the landing function, as you recall, this is the first route of the first page. Our first, this is with the landing view. With, you see, our templates that have been rendered in HTML. So now we want some interaction. When people, they will click on this button, we want the user to get logged in Facebook. And we want to take this access token so that we can get his friends. You see, my ID is login button for this button. And we go back to the landing view. This is how you specify events, I mean user events, in this region of the code. We just specify, okay, if there is a click on the login button, then you call this function, click login button, which is just here. And inside we do some Facebook initialization. I don't want to get into details because this is about Backbone. But basically we log in into Facebook and we store this access token in the collection. Each time the user click on the button. Finally, there is a convention that if you want the default behavior of the widget to get applied, you can return true. If you don't want the default behavior, you return false. What does it mean? It means that, okay, this is an anchor, and I specified the href to go to the friends page, so I want it to apply. You click here, you log in into Facebook, and you go to the friends page. Our friend page. This friend page is in fact the friends view, which is linked to the collection because we need to render these friends on the left, and also to the winners because we need to render them also. This is how we specify the link. We initialize the friends view, which is a new friends view. We specify the model that will be used, the collection. And this is the code for the friends view. Pretty similar to the landing view. But here is something interesting in the initialize function. It's that we listen for events from the models. This is where all the data driven is working. So the first line is specify that, okay, if the model that we use is triggering a change event, then we want the view to render itself. So basically this change event is called each time there is a change of attribute in the model. And then the second line is a bit similar, but the convention is that, okay, if the collection trigger a reset event, which means that the fetch function has been called and then all the friends model have been created, then we will want the page to render again. And if you go back in the router, in our friends function, you see here that we're not calling the render function of the friends view,
but we're calling the fetch function of the friends collection, because we have defined this event, this binding of events, that each time there is a reset from the friends collection, the page will, the friends view will re-render. Okay? Then we have also the render function, basically. This is the same as the landing view, but we have some more properties that we give to the template, because we want to customize the view with different friends. And then for the events, we have basically two user events that you want to handle. The click on the checkbox to set one of the top friends, and click on the publish button. And you see
for the checkbox, we will go to the click choice, and for the publish, we'll go to the click publish function.
So basically, that's how this app is working. If you want to see the code, it's available on GitHub. So why using it? Why using Backlog? It's very small. It's not like a huge framework that you have to put and you have to spend a lot of time to learn. It's more like very small, and I think you get a lot of pains for the bugs, you know? Because it's only 6 KB, and then you can customize it, okay, you want to change the template. There is many ways to do the things, so it's pretty flexible. Then there is no assumption about your UI, how you do your scaling, how you do this kind of stuff. You still use your HTML and CSS. It's data driven. And at the end, we have a more maintainable code, and it means for us developers, the fun is more long term. So some problems with the libraries and carrots. I think the main one is SEO, because I mean, if you're creating an app like Gmail, you don't really care that Google Crawler, Google Bot is coming to your app. You don't want that, so it's okay to use Bootstrap by the way for this. But in the case of you do something where you want Google and Google Crawler to come, because the views they are rendered on the client side with JavaScript, and the crawler will not execute the JavaScript, it will be a problem. But I guess this will. There are some projects working on that, so that you can reuse this views also on the server side. So who's using it? Backbone is becoming more mature now, because there is a lot of companies using it, like Khan Academy or some huge startups like Foursquare, or even big companies like Groupon. Even LinkedIn is using it for the mobile application. Also, it's quite popular on GitHub. You see it's on the top 10 of the most watched Google stories. So I guess it will get used more and more. Let me conclude the presentation with some resources. Basically, yeah, the official documentation. You can have a good ebook if you like to learn something with an ebook from this guy at US Money. Also, there is good videos on pipcode to start learning it. Yeah, that's the end.
The template, what exactly does it do when it does HTML generate? How does it convert the JSON into manual? Template rendering and
so the question is how you change that into
JSON. It
stores it as JSON, right? Basically, this template is very simple because there is no attributes inside. I mean, you cannot change it. So it's basically you have the HTML. This is the HTML you will get. But then you can, for example, okay, let's go here.
Yeah.
Just one more thing. Why is it in the script tag only? Why not in the div? Because when you're specifying the ID dot HTML, right? Dot HTML is just a jQuery function to just give you the HTML of that tag.
Yeah.
So why is it in the script and not in some div, which is just hidden?
Okay. So I mean, the question is more is why is it directly in the index.html file?
Why is it in a script tag instead of some other div?
I mean, it's
specifically.
I mean, this application is very simple and there is not like 50 different templates, so it's not a problem to store them in the main file. And also, you can do things differently. You can store them on the separate files, and then you can load them with AJAX requests. But if you don't have so much templates in your app, you can store them directly.
Is it in the script tag because it's underscore template or? I think the question was why
it's
outside the script tag?
Well, I mean,
yeah.
Why
not
some tag?
Yeah, you can do that any tag, of course.
You can add it in any tag, but it will render on the page actually. You need to give it to the
null.
You need to give it to the null otherwise. If you use it in script tag, it doesn't actually.
You just have to tell to the browser, okay, this is not JavaScript. So you put whatever you want here. If here it's text template. Just say, okay, what is your selector? Okay, when there is a click event on this element in your DOM, call this function, which is here. So you can have click, you can have mouse enter, mouse hover, I mean, whatever events you
prefer. The question here is in the this.html,
this.
Line 13.
Yeah. Okay.
So how exactly does that function?
How is it working from here? Okay, so this dot dollar el is a shortcut for this dot el parenthesis that you put the dollar at the beginning. So basically some jQuery thing. And you specify, okay, now you here is your HTML and you call this template, and this template will get the HTML. Because basically here, you tell, okay, my template is there, and compile it, and then when I call you, and compile it and store it here, and this is a function, and you call it, and then it will get you the HTML. Do what?
Opposite.
Yeah?
And this is after the top. He wants to take it offline.
Yeah, we can.
You said why backbone? You told about you told the feature about backbone 6 key or something. But why backbone? Why not Sami or some other similar framework? There are other similar framework, right? So why
backbone? More simple. Simpler.
So, okay, simple.
I mean, yeah, I looked at different. For me, it was more like, okay, do I have, will I take some huge framework like Ember or something like that, which will be maybe 1 megabyte, you know? Or do I take a small library which is only 6 KB and people they're talking, they are very positive about it, and the author of the library is saying, okay, there is many ways to do things, so you're not stuck into one way of thinking. And I tried it and I think it's very interesting.
Since it's going to be a single page application, so you said next year is going to be a big problem. So any best way of the SEO for this kind of application? If there's a content page site,
yeah,
which is using backbone. So I personally want that the content should be SEO.
Yeah.
Should be search, search engine optimized, right?
Yeah.
So there are some problems with agent based application. So what's the best thing, I mean, best kind of the more method to have the SEO now?
I would say it would be good to work with Node.js on the server side. And if there is a way to reuse these views that you have on the client and you render them on the server, then Google can see the pages. But I'm not there yet. And there is not yet like very mature project dealing with this problem.
It is HTML, but that's a headless browser. You can run on the server, give the same URL, it will give you the output. But that's okay. I mean, it has a lot of bugs. So I was thinking if there's something else, something better than that.
Yeah, that's not good.
How does it perform when it's integrated with some other technologies in the backend? Let's say for business layer or process layer, you want to use some other technology.
So
does it perform well in that way, or how do you work with that?
So the question is it, does it perform well with other backend technologies? I would say it's only there is no interaction really with the backend because it's only JavaScript files on the client. I read people that have rewrite applications with Backbone and they said, oh, no, it's more maintainable, it's more structured, and it's faster. So,
yeah. And how much is the ecosystem? What are the editors available or what is the
development? We don't really need an editor. It's more like what we use to code JavaScript.
Okay.
You have one script to add in your page.
So are enough documentation or tutorials available on this? Or?
Yeah, the documentation is quite good, quite nice. But at first, it's a bit. There are some concepts that are difficult to grasp if you just look at domain documentation. This is why some ebook or some videos to ease the start.